Hello everybody, welcome along to another edition of the Rebel Wide Ball. And as is becoming more customary at this stage, we need to do a little bit of a look back before we do any forward predicting as to what may happen this weekend. And of course, the big story from last weekend was probably the best game of football we've seen for a while. That was a game between Armagh and Galway, which was eventually, as you know, won by Galway in penalties. And if we just could stop there for one moment, the amount of outrage that followed on, that games could be decided by penalties, Gaelic football games be decided by penalties, did create a lot of outrage. But I think it's important for people to realise that the reason why games finishing on the day was brought into play in the first place, okay, it meant a loss of money, but leave that out of it, is because they wanted to bring some certainty to fixtures programmes. And for those of you who are hanging around the planet, maybe as long as I have been, how many times have we seen replays wreaking havoc with fixtures that were made by county boards and divisional boards, and it was about time it stopped. And I, for one, totally support these games finishing on the day. Right, somebody would say that maybe they could have played it next Sunday. Fair enough, I would give them that if they can finish games within the time allotted to the inter-county season, fair enough. But there's no doubt in my mind that you have an agenda out there trying to get rid of the split season, wanting to extend the inter-county into August, right? They talk about tradition and all of that, but get one thing straight. This is going to, if it happens, curtail the already very limited space that's available for club games. And it's been driven forward for one thing, money, okay, exposure and all of that. But the big media organisations like RT, Sky, the main newspapers, the main journalists, they want this to come on principally because it's huge revenue and also it's an easy way of working. I would contend that there's a whole area of untapped potential out there in the various county championships throughout the country if the media want to bring them into the homes of the nation, if you like. Anyway, that was the first thing. And I mean, the carry-on of some of these guys, that sense of outrage about it being so unfair for a game to be finished in penalties. I mean, and so cruel. The word cruel was used in a few occasions. I never thought that there was any aspect of losing that wasn't cruel, to be honest with you. Any time that I had ever to experience it. It wasn't a very pleasant experience for a start, let me tell you, regardless of whether it was a 20-point defeat or a point in the last minute of a county final kicked by a guy who never scored a point before or after to finish a promising coaching career. Anyway, the sense of outrage by these media guys, look, it doesn't run with me, far from it. Anyway, the other thing, of course, then that happened was the melee at the end of the game. And that gave rise to massive, massive outcry on the media and social media and all of that. And we'll get one thing out of the way. What Tiernan Kelly did to Damien Comer, nobody will condone it. But the amount of grief visited upon him and the interference by politicians and do-gooders in society, Charlie Flanagan, take your hat off, Charlie. What a man. What service you've given your country. Catherine Martin, that member of the Green Party, she decided to lay in about children being... Any child didn't see this on Sunday. You couldn't see it. Nobody saw this thing, only watched it on television. Five-year-old children. Well, they must be different to some of the kids that I've been hanging around with. That they were absolutely abhorred by this thing. Look, get real here. These are opportunists. Will be dealt with by the GAA, and there'll be no such thing as anybody appealing this particular decision. The young man that was involved in it, it's a moment of bad judgment. Shouldn't have done it. He's apologised for it. He'll be punished. Move on. Chapter 3, please. What's more concerning, though, if I was from Armagh, is a lot of columnists and media people were really annoyed, if you like, or pointing the finger at a lot of stuff that went on in that match in terms of verbals and off the ball carry on by the Armagh team. And you have some people from the north, like there's sometimes you'll be accused of an insulter bias, if you like. But when you see fellas like Joe Brawley and I know Owen Mulligan and all of that, point, you know, suggesting that Armagh would need to clean up their act, in other words. And I remember watching the game, and Damien Comer, Hardy Cutter, he is right, playing full forward for Galway, could see he was getting grief. And Shane Walsh, who was an outstanding Gaelic footballer, albeit that he nearly kicked the game away in the end, going down injured. And I've seen these fellas playing matches where they don't go down injured. So it did trigger what's going on here. But anyway, what it means after, like, it was a great game of football. That's the most important thing. We'll get that right and we won't forget it for a while. What I was thinking about was the Galway goalkeeper, who nobody thought about how, if Galway lost, how it was going to affect him, because definitely his two blunders did contribute. Armagh were gone in this game. Getting two goals in injury time, like, that's the case of desperation. Two high balls, long balls in that they were never... It is so unlike modern day tactics. They just gave up on the end, lashed it in, and it got the goals that gave it extra time and the penalty shooter. And my God, those Galway penalty takers, they were absolutely top class, better than I've seen any court for a long time. It's interesting, that match, that the Armagh goalkeeper is not one at all, and the Galway goalkeeper has a big background in League of Ireland soccer. That probably stood him, you know, when he was standing and go for those penalties. But anyway, that was that. It means now that the All-Ireland semi-final is going to be the game between Dublin and Kerry after their easy enough victories and one-sided matches last weekend. Derry also, a one-sided game against Clare. So Derry and Galway, at least there's potential for two good matches there. And this weekend we have the All-Ireland hurling finals. And again, we have potential for two good games. On Saturday at 5:30, Kilkenny taking on Clare, and I don't know how you're going to predict who's going to win this one. Clare, the last day probably were gone against Wexford, played well in the Munster Championship. Kilkenny, they lost a couple of games in their Leinster Championship. So there's, as I say, the potential there is because they appear to be two evenly matched sides. The other one, anything other than a Limerick win in the 3:30 game on Sunday would be a major surprise against Galway. And for those who follow the fortunes of the minor hurling, on this Sunday at 1:30, Nolan Park, you have who's playing in that head, Offaly taking on Tipperary there, and you'd imagine that, you know, the Tipperary would be the favourites in that one. Now we're moving, and do you know, when I was talking earlier about the county championships, like, I've met so many people over the last couple of weeks who are already looking forward to the various championships, even the divisional junior football and junior hurling championships. They're talking about them because they're laid out in stone. Everybody knows what's happening. The format is perfect. And that's all thanks to Conny Covid. Make no mistake about it. What he brought, let no man take away from us. This weekend we have, on Tuesday night we had two matches this is a bit complicated, but anyways, the Premier Senior Hurling unseeded divisional section, where you had Duhallow defeating Carrigdon. A good game it was too. They won 22 points to 19. Sean Howard was the main scorer there, but there were seven other scorers on the board for Duhallow. It was a narrow enough victory, but in the second game, Avondhu were much too strong, it must be said, for Muskie, who made a great effort this year, but Avondhu winning 3-18 to 19 points in the end. And here's Stephen Condon, I think he's in Glenwood, got 1-10. So next Tuesday night, these two teams meet, Avondhu and Duhallow, and whoever will win that will join UCC's MTU and Imokilly to play in another kind of a competition, two semi-finals and final, and whoever wins that goes into the Premier Senior Hurling Championship proper. In football tonight, we have the two semi-finals of the one-seeded football section in both games at 7:30. In Bantry, we have Carbery, who will be the favourites, taking on Beara. And Beara, who couldn't get a player last year probably to play with him, they have about 36 or 8 on the panel now. And regardless of what happens tonight, it's a victory in itself. They got players out to play for Beara, and obviously it does mean something playing for these divisions. There's a lot of work to go on. A lot of work has happened, more is to be done, if you like. And in the other semi-final, Imokilly, fair play to them, they've got a team out, and they're going to be playing in Ballinoe against Avondhu, and Avondhu will be the raging hot favourites there, if you wish. Then we have the County Junior B clubs that play, the County, sorry, Junior B Hurling and Football Clubs. They're so well catered for, I think, in this county now. They've their own separate divisional championships, and if and clubs that win that go on to a county championship. But there's an open county for Junior B clubs only. And this weekend we have the two Junior B hurling championship semi-finals taking place. And Friday night, a place called Fremont, if you ever heard of it, taking on Gabriel Rangers from Skull in Dunamore. I think Gabriel Rangers would be the favourites in that one. And then Saturday in Ovens at 4 o'clock, Randloke, who had an incredible season last year, particularly their football team, they're taking on Ballyclaw. Probably fine. I think Ballyclaw would be good enough for them in that one. And finally, we have the Junior C Football Championship. And I actually didn't think that Ballyfeahan had a team, but seemingly they have. And they take on Lismore, 3 o'clock in Morton Abbey on Sunday. And whoever wins that would be playing Fremont. So they're in the hurling B and the football C. They'll be taking on Fremont on the following Sunday. So that's kind of our GA section, if you like. In Camogie ladies football, well, there's two matches in Camogie this Saturday. You have both court teams in action. The intermediate team, I should say first of all that the senior in the County Camogie Championship and the Intermediate Championship are run in the same format. 12 teams in each, divided two groups of six. Every team gets 5 matches, and the top team in each group goes to a semi-final, and the second and third in each group play in quarter-finals. So the Cork Intermediates, I think, look, they have a great chance of, they could even make the semi-final, despite the fact they were beaten last week by Derry. They take on Kildare and Páirc Uaireann. I expect them to get over that, and depending on how Derry get on, they will be through to a semi-final or a quarter-final. If it is a quarter-final, they play on the 9th, but if it is a semi-final a week later on the 16th, and the senior team who won all their matches take on Tipperary, and regardless of how they get on, they're going to be playing the All-Ireland semi-final on the 9th, on the 23rd of July, my apologies, on the 23rd of July, and the final of that then is on the 7th of September, and on the 7th of August. And as we've been saying from the start, the Intercounty Camogie is down to 3 teams, Cork, Galway and Kilkenny. In football, we saw last week where the ladies footballers maybe struggled in the first half, but got over Waterford, and they now won their 2 matches, which means they're in an All-Ireland quarter-final. And in that quarter-final, they will be playing Mayo and Innes on July the 9th. And whether to win that, the good story is they're avoiding Meath and Dublin. They'll be playing either Kerry or Armagh. So I expect them to make the All-Ireland final, which will be fixed for Sunday, July 13th. So the Camogie team and the ladies football team doing quite well. I meant to mention earlier on like that we have a number of inter-county managers stepping down. We've Seamus McEnany stepping down yesterday in the from the Monaghan job, with James Horne last week. I see where Tomás O'Shea has been mentioned as a potential successor up in Offaly. No, I haven't heard that John Mahons had stepped down, but we have the hurling job here in Cork, and my God, I'm not too sure what went on here last week, where like everybody's convinced that Kieran Kingston is staying on. It would appear to me that Kieran Kingston was never offered a one-year extension, where that story came from Shinnesepa. But I'd imagine there'll be some sort of a review carried out. And like appointing a manager, and that may be a problem here in Cork, it also involves the coaching staff. So there's a county board meet, I think, next Tuesday night. I presume the executive will meet before that, and there may be some progress. But this could run a little, and is by no means, I would think, a done deal. And I say for 1 minute that Kieran Kingston, I think that Kieran and the coaching staff, did a good job in that Cork curling, as we said. Okay, beaten by Galway, and I know that was majorly disappointing, but they're still there or thereabouts. I know you could argue this until whatever cause you have come home, and some people won't agree with us in our view of it, and that's A1 as well. So moving on to soccer, and the story from League of Ireland Soccer, I suppose, is the contrast between Cork City and Cove Ramblers. First of all, Cork City, a big win, 5-0 over Treaty United on Monday night. Galway losing the same night, 2-0 to Longford Town, which means now there's 4 points between the two teams at the top. And It's Cork playing Bray. They travel to Bray this weekend on a real high. Cove Ramblers eventually change managers, and Shane Keegan is the guy now that's in charge. And by all accounts, you know, he's had work with Wexford Youths, Dundalk and Galway United, and he comes with a big pedigree. So he's a big job of work to do, no doubt in the world about that. And they take on Treaty United in Cove on Friday night, so there probably should be a big enough crowd in at that, because of it being his first match in charge of them. In rugby, well, yesterday morning, Ireland's 5 match tour of New Zealand began, when Ireland's, I suppose, second team take on the All Blacks, the Maori All Blacks. That's kind of their second team, and didn't do very well. Even though the scoreline at the end, 32-17, mightn't indicate that, but they really recapitulated in the second quarter of that game, and at halftime it was 32-10, and you know, they didn't score anymore. Ireland did get a try through the very impressive Gavin Coombs from a Cork point of view. That was good, but it basically means, well, I'm not saying that game really meant an awful lot, but this Saturday, for the next 3 Saturdays, at 5:05 in the morning, the Ireland will be playing the All Blacks. The first one they're taking on in Auckland, then in Dunedin, and finally in Wellington. And before the last test game, the Ireland selection will take on the Maori All Blacks as well. So I know that a lot of you, you know, our followers, will be getting up early on Saturday morning and the following Saturday and all of that. Finally, this week we have golf, and it's the Irish Open, and the golfing fraternity, some of them are already on their way to the Kilkenny venue of Mount Juliet, because this is where it's staged on this occasion. And of course, Ireland, okay, Rory McIlroy isn't there on this occasion. He's, you know, taking a bit of a break, if you wish, and I think he's playing in the JP McManus Pro-Am in Adair next week, before the British Open. But I suppose the main story from an Ireland point of view is that Seamus Power and Shane Lowry will be leading the challenge. Paddy Harrington is also in there, and so too from a Cork point of view, John Murphy from Kinsale, delighted that he got an invitation. So Lowry and Power, like, it's a 4-day event like all of these are, and Lowry and Paul are paired together for the first 2 days. They teed off at 8 o'clock this morning, and they will tee off at 1 o'clock tomorrow. So it would be great if one of them, or obviously any Irish player, will win it. Remember, Lowry did win it as an amateur back in 2009 in Royal Portrush. So that's basically it, my friends. And our wish, as always, is that whenever we do this again, that we'll have a full roll call. And, you know, our gratitude and our thanks for whatever attention you pay to this, I was going to say a Ramesh, but didn't fall off it.